this evening, if you would, join me in the Old Testament in the second book of the law, the book of Deuteronomy, the second chapter. Deuteronomy chapter 2. Commencing at verse 1, concluding at verse number 7 of Deuteronomy chapter number 2. Then we turned and took our journey into the wilderness by the way of the Red Sea, as the Lord spake unto me, and we can pass Mount Seir many days. And the Lord spake unto me, saying, ye have compassed this mountain long enough. Turn you northward, and command thou the people, saying, you are to pass through the coast of your brethren, the children of Esau, which dwell in Seir, and they shall be afraid of you. Take good heed unto yourselves, therefore. Meddle not with them, for I will give you not of their land, no, not so much as a foot breadth. Because I've given Mount Seir unto Esau for a possession. And ye shall buy meat of them for money that ye may eat. And ye shall buy water of them for money that ye may drink. For the Lord thy God has blessed thee in all the works of thine hand. He knoweth thy walking through this great wilderness. These 40 years the Lord thy God hath been with thee, and thou hast lacked nothing. As the Spirit of God would give guidance and grace, I want to talk tonight from this simple thought and theme: breaking the holding pattern. Breaking the holding pattern. If you would, you may claim your seats in the presence of our God. Posture with us in prayer. Oh God, our God, we thank you and we praise you for your grace and for your mercy. We thank you for your love and your kindness towards us. And God, we thank you for your presence in this place. To that end, oh God, I pray now that you would anoint me afresh for the proclamation and the declaration of your word. May your word have free course in this place this night. Speak to us. Give joy to those who are sorrow. Give hope to those who are in despair. Give faith even now, O God, to those who are bouting with fear. Be glorified. And God, I pray now that you would use me to your glory and your glory only. In Jesus Christ's name we pray in. And all the saints of the Lord said, amen. Some years ago, I had the privilege of preaching on the West Coast. And I was making my journey, my trip back to Atlanta, Georgia. While on the plane, leaving the West Coast, coming to Atlanta, the captain on the PA system of the plane gave an announcement that the plane had been placed in what is known as a holding pattern. The plane was placed in a holding pattern because there was apparently some logistical challenges, or second of all, because there was some congestion on the land. And thus it was determined in the control tower that it was not conducive, it was not convenient, it was not wise to land. So that plane was placed in a holding pattern. As I was there, some 30 plus feet in the atmosphere, my homiletic mind kicked into gear. And I began to think within myself of how there are some amazing parallelism between this experience of the plane being placed in the holding pattern as it relates also to how individuals and institutions alike are placed in holding patterns. One of the interesting things that I discovered is that I was able to look out of the window and was able to see the city, but yet couldn't land. I saw my destination, but couldn't land. Furthermore, as I began to examine this reality of the holding pattern, I was stuck between my place of departure and my place of destiny, and I was dealing with a period of delay. And if you were to take a brief moment and begin to survey your personal pilgrimage through life, there are some within this sanctuary that can readily attest that I've been there, that I've had some holding patterns in my life in which I felt as if I was stuck between my place of departure and my place of destiny. And I was dealing with a period of delay. I know where I'm supposed to be, but I'm dealing with a period of delay and I'm unable to land at my final destination. And I believe that there is someone in this sanctuary tonight that can readily attest that even when I look at my life today, I'm in a holding pattern, but I've come to declare I have some good news. I've come to declare that this night, your holding pattern is going to be broke. But the question that we must wrestle with in the text is, what was the causation behind Israel being placed in this holding pattern that had lasted for some 40 long years? It's not before I begin, until we begin to examine the first chapter, that we can discover what actually occurred with Israel. Israel was placed in a holding pattern that had lasted for 40 long years for two reasons. A, it was because they were regressive in their attitude. And then B, they were rebellious to authority. Whenever you study Israel history, you would discover that oftentimes, more often than not, they were placed in a holding pattern that had lasted for a long duration because they were regressive in their attitude. They were still stuck on Egypt. Every time they would hit a speed bump on the road towards their deliverance, they would oftentimes begin to reflect upon how wonderful life was in Egypt. They were regressive in their attitude. And then second of all, they were rebellious to authority. Because whenever God would speak to them through the mouthpiece Moses, they would oftentimes challenge the authority of Moses. And thus God places them in a holding pattern that had lasted for 40 long years. But here in chapter 2, we discover that God begins to speak to them. Perhaps the saddest words ever recorded in Israelic history is right here in verse number 1 of chapter 2. Then we turned and took our journey into the wilderness. I declare perhaps these are the saddest words of Israelic history, in that the final destination for Israel was never the wilderness. But rather, God had promised them, even through the patriarchs, that they will inhabit a land flowing with milk and honey. And the wilderness is not that place. They turned and took their journey into the wilderness by way of the Red Sea. And the Lord spake unto me, and we can pass Mount Seir many days. And the Lord spake unto me, saying, ye have come past this mountain long enough. Turn ye northward. The point in the text is simply this. If you're going to break the holding pattern in your life, number one, you must be willing to go in a new direction. He says in verse number 3, you've come past this mountain long enough. Turn and go northward. In other words, they were at Mount Seir in the land of Moab. And they were going around this mountain in a circulative, redundant, and repetitive fashion. They kept going around the circumference of this mountain. The shouting part is that God spoke to Moses. God spoke to Moses. Watch this here now. Even while they were in their wilderness. Now, someone even right there can give God praise, because there's been times in your life that you were in your personal wilderness. But isn't it refreshing to know that God still will speak to you even when you're in your wilderness, even when you were rebellious, even when you were aggressive? God will still speak. He speaks to them and says, You've been going around this mountain long enough. By now, you ought to be dizzy. You're going around in a circulative, redundant, repetitive fashion around the circumference of this mountain. Begin to think about it, how all of us, if the truth be told, we've had those type of redundant experiences. If you were just to take a brief moment and look at your life, it's the same old redundant life. Nothing new, nothing exciting, nothing fresh. Just the same old boring, redundant, stale, tired life. It's the 285 situation. We all got a 285 story. All those who have migrated here to Atlanta, you have a 285 story. I never will forget living off of Old National Highway at the Biscayne's apartment in College Park. My sister had given me directions as it relates to how to make it to Clark Atlanta University. She said, Craig, you want to get on 285. You want to proceed down 285 until you come to 7585. Get off 7585 and then go watch us here north. And then once you go north, she then gave the other directions. Now watch this here. I heard everything but 7585. You know the rest of the story. I kept going around 285. Got to the point that I discovered that I was seeing the same things I'd seen some 40 minutes ago. You're laughing at my story, but if the truth be told, if you look at your life is a 285. Because all you're doing is going around and around in a circle. If you want to break the holding pattern in your life, you must be willing to go in a new direction. Listen, settle on your saddle. Watch this here. Let me explain again why individuals and institutions get stuck in the wilderness. More often than not, it's because they are unwilling to go in new directions. They get stuck in one mold, one method, one approach. And fear change. So they keep treading in the same familiar territory. Trying to figure out what happened. Died because of failure to adjust. Text makes mention, watch this here, that God speaks to Moses and says, go in a new direction. Two things I want to share with you as it relates to this whole matter of going in a new direction. First of all, you must be responsive to your visionary. The text says in verse number 1 and verse number 2 that the Lord spake unto me. The antecedent of this word me is referring back to Moses. He did not speak to a caucus, clan, or committee, but he spoke directly to Moses. Spoke to Moses, not the multitude, but spoke to Moses. Because some of us have this whole idea of leadership misconstrued. You will never discover in Scripture where God spoke to a multitude. He speaks to a man who in turn speaks to the multitude. Even when God gives a vision, watch this here. The vision is dictated by the Lord, disclosed to the leader, declared to the laity. When God speaks to Habakkuk, he says, Habakkuk, you go up into the watchtower. I'm going to dictate the vision because I'm the visionary. I'm going to dictate it to the leader, you, Habakkuk. You, in turn, discuss it with the laity. He spoke to Moses. Now, if God is speaking to Moses, that implies to me that you ought to be militant-minded as it relates to your Moses. Because your deliverance out of your wilderness is predicated upon God speaking to Moses. So you ought to have an attitude as it relates to your pastor. You can't say nothing about my pastor. Don't gossip about my pastor. Don't talk about my pastor. Because my destiny is tied up in Moses. Matter of fact, you ought to have a little hood up in you. You ought to say, listen, if you're going to get to my pastor, you got to come through me. And you can't get through me because watch this here. My destiny, my future, my life is tied up. Got to be. Settling yourself. I'm just warming up. You got to be responsive to your visionary. Don't refute. Don't rebel. Don't resist. spoke to Moses. Responsive to the visionary, he says to Moses, you've been going in this direction too long now. It's time to go in a new direction. And even right now, Travelers Rest ought to give God praise because you have a pastor who heard from Moses, who heard from God, who declared, listen, it's time to go in a new direction. And look at what God is doing here in Hot Decatur. Look at how God is blessing you, growing by leaps and bounds. Name is throughout the nation. Look at what God is doing because you was willing to go in a new direction. Now, let me help, because some are still having a hard time with this whole matter of adjustment. The functional definition of stupidity is doing the same thing the same way, expecting new results. If you want new results, tell your neighbor, you got to be willing to do some new things. You got to be willing to go in some new directions. Responsive to your visionary, but here it is, second of all here. B, you must also remember the vision. See, when you look at the text again, Moses is challenging the people to go in a new direction because the wilderness was never the place that God had envisioned for them. They were never supposed to settle in the wilderness. He says, no, I promise you a land flowing with milk and honey called Canaan. And the wilderness is not that place. You got to remember the vision. What is a vision? A vision is a mental picture of your preferable future. A vision is not predicated upon your past, nor is a vision predicated upon your present realities, but rather a vision is looking constantly into the future. See, the problem with some of us is that we're unable to see our vision because we're looking at life through the rearview mirror. The rearview mirror is only designed to look in the rear. You got a whole windshield in front of you. You got to look forward. Have to remember the vision. Your deliverance is critical and contingent upon your ability to remember the vision, your mental picture of your preferable future. I see myself in a different place than where I am right now. This is not the end of my story. I may be in a wilderness today, but this is not the final chapter of my life. Is there anybody up in here that can testify that I got Canaan on the horizon? I'm going in a new direction. I gotta. The question was once posed of Helen Keller. The question was once posed, what would be worse than being born blind? Being a blind woman, what would be worse than being born blind? She responded by saying, to have sight with no vision. A whole lot of folks got sight. Have no vision. If you're gonna break the holding pattern, you must be willing to go in a new direction. Not only must you be willing to go in a new direction, but here it is too. You must also garner a new disposition. You must garner a new disposition. In other words, disposition, you must have a different mindset. There must be a paradigm shift. There must be a cognitive adjustment. You gotta think differently. What good would it be to go into a new locality and have the same stinking mentality? Yeah. See, the wilderness is divinely designed as God's detox program. Because if you did not have a wilderness moment, you would bring all of that Egyptian stuff with you into Canaan. So sometime he allows us to take a long journey in the wilderness because he's detoxing us of some of the things that we are subject to carry over from our past. There must be a cognitive adjustment. Got to change the way you think. Francis Frangipane, in his book, The Battlegrounds, he presents this argument. He says that the greatest battleground in life lies between the ears. That's pretty. That's pretty. He says our biggest problem is what we think. For as a man thinketh, so is he. Here it is. In other words, what you believe dictates how you behave. How you behave determines who you become. As a man thinketh, what you believe dictates how you behave. And as you continue to behave a certain way, it determines who you become. The prodigal son would have never left the pig pen if he had not had a cognitive adjustment. The text puts it this way, and when he came to himself. The implication of coming to himself implies that for a moment he was insane. There must be a cognitive adjustment. There's three things I want to say real quick about this whole cognitive adjustment, that if you're going to have a cognitive adjustment, here it is. Number one, you must mitigate your fears. You cannot go into the new frontier that God has for you when you're functioning out of fear. You gotta mitigate your fears, because your fears will cause you to stay stuck where you are. You're scared to try anything new. You're scared to step out because fear has you entrapped. You have to mitigate your fears. You got to mitigate your fears. My son CJ taught me one of the greatest lessons on fear. We were at home one sunny summer day, out at the pool. He had just recently learned the art of swimming. He's doing his thing. He's in the 3 feet, swimming from one side to the other, the width of the pool. I said, CJ, you would have more fun if you would swim from the 3 to the 5. He says, Daddy, he says, when I swim from one side to the other in the 3, I can swim, stop, and stand. He says, because the water won't over flood my head, I can stand up in it. I said, CJ, but you only stroke about 2 times and you're on the other side of this. He says, but Daddy, if I swim to the 5, it's more water than it is of me. I said, but CJ, watch this here. The technique of swimming and the buoyancy of your body does not change based upon the depth of the water. The technique is the same in the 3 as it is in the 5. He says, but Daddy, I can't stand in the 5. He said, I tell you what, CJ, watch this here. I'm going to stay in the water. I'm going to walk to the 5 because I'm 6'1". You walk around the side of the pool. Meet me on the other end. He said, all right. I said, now, CJ, jump. He said, Daddy, the water is too much. I said, CJ, but I got you. What do you mean you have me? I said, CJ, listen, from your perspective, you don't understand. I'm standing on the foundation. The question is not so much, are you scared of the water? The real question is, can you trust me with what you can't handle? Come here real quick. That's all God is asking somebody. Yeah, it may look deep. Yeah, it may look difficult. Yes, it may look impossible. But God is saying, listen, don't look at the issue. Look at me. Can you trust me? And can I tell you what my boy did? My boy came off that wall, started swimming.
Watches though, he kept swimming, but while he was in the fire, I pulled my hands from up under him, but my boy, I'm standing here, he pops up here, he says, Daddy, how do I get from here to there? I said, son, you got from the 5 to the 3, the same way you went from the 3 to the 3. What do you mean, Daddy? I pull my hands from up under you because I wanted you to learn. That you can depend on all shucks. Is there anybody up in here that feels like giving God praise? Because there's been some things in your life that God helped you to conquer your fears. And look at you now. You can handle some things better today.
You got it. So settle yourself, sir. I'm almost there. Settle. See, you can never go forward with your life if you're functioning out of fear. God has not given me the spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. Turn to your neighbor and tell your neighbor, I ain't scared. I may be in the wilderness, but I ain't scared. I just don't believe that he's brought me this far. I ain't scared to leave me. Is there anybody up in here?
You gotta.
You know, matter of fact, the 23rd Psalm, I love it, gives the best advice on how to handle your fears. That one classic line of David. David says, and when I walk through the valley, that'll preach by itself. Because if you're in a valley, at some point you come to the lowest point. And if you keep on walking, at some point you gotta come out of it. Well, he says, and when I'm in this valley, I will fear no evil. But David, can you tell me how? Really, when you look at the 23rd Psalms and conduct a critical analysis of the 23rd Psalms, you and I can see some of the practical points that David provides as it relates to how we can eliminate and eradicate fear from the context of our hearts. Listen to what David says. Matter of fact, let's just recite it real quick. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thy art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thy prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thy anointeth my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Now that sounds real good. But listen to what David says. He says, the Lord, definite article, the Lord is my personal pronoun, the known in ownership and possession, my shepherd. The fundamental purpose and position of the shepherd is to precede the sheep. For two reasons, he precedes the sheep because, watch this here, he guides the sheep. Someone say guides. The sheep will never make it to the green pastures nor to the still waters unless the shepherd guides the sheep. But he not only guides the sheep, but second of all, he guards the sheep. Because as the sheep are sipping from the water, are eating from the green pastures, oftentimes beasts will come and try to ambush the flock. But if the shepherd is there, the shepherd will stand up and guard the sheep. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff. I have my shepherd in front, but I have my rod in the right hand. The rod is symbolical or emblematical of discipline. because every now and then the sheep would get out of the path of righteousness, and God must take the rod of discipline to get the sheep walking right again. I have my shepherd in front, my rod on the right, but I have my staff on the left. Now the staff is a long stick with a hook on the end, because oftentimes the sheep, as they're sipping from the rivers and the ravine, will fall down into the water. And because of the density of the wool that's on the sheep, if they fall down, they will go down and drown. But the shepherd stands on the shore and wraps a hook around the sheep's neck and pulls the sheep to safety. Oh, shucks, someone ought to shout right there. Because there's been some moments in your life that you've fallen down in some stuff. But you ought to give God praise that your shepherd stood on the shore and delivered you. I have my shepherd in front, my rod on the right, my staff on the left. But the text also says, and he anoints my head with oil. What is the anointing? The anointing is the enabling power of God to do in and through you what you innately and inherently can't do yourself. The anointing is not based upon your education. The anointing is not based upon your degrees. The anointing is not based upon your financial accumulation. It's the enabling power of God to do in and through you what you innately can't do yourself. And I don't know about you, but I need his anointing. I need his power. I need his grace. How else have your pastor been pastoring these years? It's because God has anointed his head with oil. And I've come to declare that every individual in the house of God ought to be anointed. You ought not usher one person down the aisle until you say, Lord, anoint me. You ought not pick up one Sunday school lesson and teach anybody until you say, Lord, anoint me. You ought not play one organ. I pluck not one guitar until you say, Lord, anoint me. You ought not turn a key on the sound system until you say, Lord, anoint me. I need your anointing. But the anointing oil was also placed on the heads of the sheep because it served like insect repellent. Because as the sheep would be eating out in the grass, different insects and bugs would come and irritate the sheep. But when the oil was on the sheep's head, it repelled the bugs that was irritating it. Oh, come on, somebody in here ought to relate to that point. Because there's been some folks on your job, in your home, even up in the church, that's been getting on your last nerve, that's been bugging you, and look at you, you're still here. Because he's anointed you. I have my shepherd in front, my rod on the right, my staff on the left. My head is anointed. And on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. That's why I haven't gone down. That's why I'm still here. I have my shepherd in front, my rod on the right, my staff on the left. My head is anointed. I'm on a firm foundation. And I got two pit bulls. Goodness and mercy are following me all the days of my life. Is there anybody up in here that can testify I'm covered on every side? That's why I can testify no weapon formed against me shall prosper.
Settling your saddle. I'm almost there. Settle. Here it is. You got to mitigate your fears. Just settle your saddle. I'm almost there. Not only must you mitigate your fears, but second of all, you have to mobilize your faith. See this journey that you're on. Requires faith. Yeah. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things, the title deeds of things that are not seen. You gotta have faith. You gotta have faith. Now the problem with the body of Christ is that we suffer from what can be defined as an anemic faith. See, anybody can shout about faith in the safety of the sanctuary. But when you walk up out of here, when you're dealing with some real issues,
when life has you backed up against the wall, you gotta have faith. Now, Romans 10 explains this whole issue of faith development. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by, which means that the degree to which I discipline myself for the intake of scripture determines the depth of my faith. Really what the text is saying in Romans 10, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God, is simply this here. The quantity of your faith is determined by the quality of your hearing. If you're not hearing and reading faith-enhancing material, see, that's why you got to turn off the television. American Idol ain't going to give you any faith. No, ain't none of that. No. I got to spend time in His Word. Because the more I study His Word, the more my faith is fertilized, formalized, and even furthered. I got to mitigate my fears and mobilize my faith. But watch this here. Stay with me. Here it is. See, I have to maintain my focus. Because this territory, this environment that you're in is hostile to your faith. You got to maintain your focus. Watch this here. And your focus is not your present reality. No, it's not. It's not your present reality. Where you are is not your final destination. You got to maintain your focus. Let me explain why. Because there are some folks that you have allowed in your life that are comfortable with Mount Seir and comfortability breeds complacency, and complacency breeds conformity. You can become so comfortable to the extent that you become complacent. And when you become complacent, you have now come to a point and a place where you are conformed to that environment. But watch this here. They are at Mount Seir, but catch this here. If you settle for Seir, you counsel Canaan. Let me say. If you settle for Seir, automatically, out of default, you have counseled Canaan. And you got to be so focused that you say, Mount Seir, as lovely as it is not the place that is my final destination. This may be a layover, but this is not where I'm to get off the plane. I got a place. I have a future. Gotta mitigate your fears, mobilize your faith, maintain your focus. But then there's a third point, and I'm about finished. If you're gonna break the holding pattern, go in a new direction. Garner a new disposition. But here it is, number three, you gotta gain a new determination. Watch the text. Watch the text. The text declares that when God spoke to them, He says, watch this here. As you go, watch the text. Verse number four. As you pass through the coast of your brethren, the children of Esau, which dwell in Seir, they shall, watch this here, be afraid of you. He says, but take good heed unto yourself. Therefore, watch what he says. He says, as you're going through Esau's territory, your brethren are going to trip out on you. They're scared of you. They're scared. Have you ever asked a question? Why so-and-so don't like me? And I haven't done nothing to him at all. I haven't talked about them, haven't said nothing. They just don't. Can I suggest to you, some folks are just annoyed with your anointing. They look at you and know you got it going on. And when they look at themselves, they see how woefully lacking they are. So when you show up, you don't gotta say anything. You don't have to just show up. Can I suggest everybody in Decatur, Hotlanta, ain't excited about E. Dewey Smith? You have some brethren afraid. Oh, I know I'm talking real good. Cause I know many of them. Hadn't said nothing, hadn't done anything. Let me tell you the issue with some folks. The issue with some folks, they have this twisted admiration. They wanna like you. And they'll come up in your face, oh, Doc, Doc. Oh, Doc, Doc. What's going on, Doc? You're doing it, Doc. But the truth of the matter, scared. Because they're sitting there saying, my God, if this happened in 4 years, what's going to happen in the fifth? How do you deal with your haters? Right in verse number 4. He says, man, take good heed to yourself. Don't trip with them. Don't lower who you are to address ignorance. Now watch this here. Whose problem really is it? You're the one scared of me. So why am I gonna waste my time trying to convince you it ain't nothing to be scared about? That's your problem. See, now that's just how I flow. You know, I'm accused of being arrogant, all that type of stuff. Man, I ain't arrogant. I just don't have time to fool with foolishness, nor fools. I mean, I'm for real. I don't have time. Two things I don't have time for: foolishness and fools. All the time you spend with folks that are foolish, you're wasting time advancing your future. Let me go ahead and bounce. Watch what it says. He says, when you go through their territory, they're gonna be afraid of you. Pull yourself together. Take good heed to yourself. Watch what he says, verse number 5. He says, don't fool with them. Meddle not with them. He said, meddle not. That's a little southern dialect. He said, don't fool with them. Meddle not with them. He said, for I haven't given you of their land. No, not so much as a foot breadth, because I've given Mount Seir to Esau for possession. He says, watch this here. As you gain this new determination, you must hear it as a resist covetousness. He says, as you're going through Esau's territory, it's going to look good, smell good. He said, only problem is, it ain't yours. He says, so when you go through, just walk on through. Don't pick up a rock. Don't pick up no sand. He said, I'm not even giving you the length of your foot. It ain't yours. Some of us counsel our future because we lust for that which doesn't belong to us. I can't begin to share with you how many folks I know who have jacked up their lives and ministry trying to have somebody else's success. I'm his friend, so I might as well go on act like I'm at home. You got so many about to jack it up trying to be E. Dewey. And they make poor copies. Because you're trying to have what ain't yours. Okay. Let me move it from pastoral. Let me make it personal. You got some folks in here jacked up. because you want something that doesn't belong to you. I'm gonna help the singles. This for free. This for free. Some of y'all never get married. And when you get married, you're gonna be miserable. We wanna know why? Because you got somebody else, Esau. Oh, I said, I'm a grown man. I'm a grown man. You forfeit your future by craving and desiring for things that don't belong to you. Let Esau have what belongs to Esau, because what God has for me. Oh, come on, don't fool me now. That's much more than a song for me. What God has for me, it is for me. You got to resist covenants. I'm about finished. Second of all, you got to recall the covenant. Because what do you do when the contents of your condition seems to contradict the content of the covenant? Okay, here it is. What do you do when the contents of your condition seemingly contradicts the content of the covenant? What do you mean? What do you do when your life doesn't look like what he promised? That's all I was saying. What do you do when your life doesn't look like what he promised? He promised you land flowing with milk and honey. He promised you that you'll be above and not beneath. You'll be the head and not the tail. But it doesn't look like it. What do you do when the context of your condition seemingly contradicts the content of the covenant? Watch this here. You must have confidence in the creator of the covenant, knowing that his character is credible. In other words, if God said it, I don't care how it looks, because I walk by faith and not by sight. It may not look like what he said, but if I keep on believing, if I keep on trusting, it's going to come to pass. Oh, is there anybody up in here that can testify it's going to come to pass? That business is going to come to pass. My future is going to come to pass. It's going to come to pass. You gotta
resist covenants. You gotta recall the covenant. Here it is. See, you must remain courageous. Got an announcement. This journey is not for punks and punkettes. I said, I'm a grown man. Scared of you. It ain't for punks and punkettes. You can't go through life always scared, always crying, always throwing a pity party, always whining, always complaining. Pull yourself together. Plant your feet, square your shoulders, lift up your head. You gotta be courageous. You gotta tell yourself, I'm coming out of this. And not only am I coming out of this, I'm coming out better than the way I went in. Is there anybody in here that can testify? I'm coming out better than the way I may look down when I went in, but listen, I'm coming out better. Let me give you this last point. Watch this here. I'm about finished. I promise y'all I'm about finished. No, I gotta go. I'm about finished. Watch this here. Watch text. Verse number six. He says, now when you go through Esau's land, watch this here. He says, if you get hungry, he says, go buy you something to eat. He said, you get thirsty, stop asking for a hookup. Can I get a hook a brother up? Hook up. No. Go buy you something to drink. Watch this here. Because this journey, especially in light of this, they don't want to call it, but let me say it for you, recession. Let me tell you what verse number six says. Verse number six says, you better become responsible with your currency. He says, I'm talking about the basic necessities of life. You need meat and water to survive. He says, watch this here. Some of us can barely deal with the basic necessities of life because we buy what we want and beg for what we need. You looking pretty,
bling bling, and broke. It just don't make no sense. Big old Gucci purse, Prada purse, Louis Vuitton, and you don't have $5 in it. Buy what you want, beg for what you need. He says, watch this. I want you to become responsible and financially independent, because once you make it to Canaan, I don't want Esau and them talking about, look what I've done for you. Look how I brought you out. No, once you make it to Canaan, I want you to give me all the glory. I want you to stand in Canaan and say, look at what God has done for me. All right. All right, I gotta go. I've enjoyed it. Thank you very much. I gotta go. But I got one last point I wanna tell somebody. If you're gonna break the holding pattern, go in a new direction. Garner a new disposition, gain a new determination. But even beyond that, you need guidance to your new destination. Look at verse number 7. He says, for the Lord thy God has blessed thee in all the works of thine hand. That's shouting news. He says, in other words, that your blessings did not come once you were emancipated from your wilderness, but even while you were in your wilderness, the Lord has been blessing you. And I wonder, is there anybody up in here that can testify that when I look over my life, I can't help but testify that the Lord has been blessing me. Deuteronomy chapter 8 declares that they walked through the wilderness for 40 long years, and their ankles never swelled. Their clothes never wore out, because the Lord had been providing. While you've been in your wilderness, somebody in here ought to be able to testify that the Lord has been providing. A matter of fact, I should have lost my mind. I should have had a nervous breakdown, but the Lord has been providing. And my testimony is just like David. I was young and now I'm old, and I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed beg for bread, because the Lord has been providing. But second of all, the Lord has been presiding. In other words, he's led me, not some of the way, but he's led me all the way. Is there anybody that feels like giving him praise? Because the Lord has been presiding. The Lord has been providing. But third of all, the Lord has been protecting against all of the assaults of the enemy, against all of dangers seen and unseen. The Lord has been protecting. You wouldn't have made it thus far if it had not been for the Lord protecting you. But not only has he been providing, not only has he been presiding, not only has he been protecting, but fourth of all, he's been preserving. Look at you. You don't look like you've been through what you've gone through, because the Lord has been preserving. Is there anybody up in here that feel like giving him praise? I've been in a wilderness, but I still have joy. I've been up and I've been down, but I still have joy.
Well, God bless you. Traveler's rest. I gotta leave you. Thank you, Pastor Smith. But I gotta go. But I have one question I wanna ask somebody. Can I ask you my one question? Don't fool me now. Can I ask you my one question? Well, tell me, how did you feel when you come out the wilderness? Somebody said, I felt like running. Somebody said, I felt like dancing. Somebody said, I felt like shouting. Tell me, how did you feel when you come out the wilderness? Say it. Say it. Say it. Hallelujah. I hear something. I hear something. I hear a voice on the PA. I hear something. I hear a voice. Fold up your folding chairs. Table, put your chair in the upright position. Cut off all electrical devices. Put all of your storage items in the bin above you. Scrap up your belt, because you have been cleared to land. The holding pattern has been broke. You have been cleared to land. The holding pattern. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, open your mouth and give him praise. I've had to fly above some storms. There was times that I thought I was going to run out of gas. But I'm on my way. The holding pattern is broken. You gotta be willing to go. Be not dismayed in a new direction. You know the number one reason why some churches never grow?
I don't care what type of pastors in the pulpit, some would never grow. Because you have some churches and church leaders who are unwilling to go in a new direction. Get stuck in one paradigm, one pattern, one approach. And I dare to say that perhaps one of the greatest acts of selfishness and self-centeredness is the assumption that your idea, your perception is the only one that counts. Have you discovered you're not the only grain at the seashore? In a new direction. And you are a blessed church to have a pastor who hears from God, who has challenged you to go in a new direction. Go in a new direction. You got to garner a new disposition. The mind, your perception has to change. Some folks are defeated already because of the mind. It's an interesting study in warfare, psychological warfare. The enemy understands, I don't have to kill you if I can kill the spirit in you. Gotta gain a new determination. That as I'm on my way to my destiny, I'm not trying to have what everybody else has. Worst mistake you can ever make is trying to keep up with the Joneses. Because you don't know the hell they catch them trying to keep what they got. You trying to keep up with broke folks who faking the funk, don't got it going on. You want to go buy a brand new house because they got a brand new house. You don't know half the room's empty. You better tell the Lord, thank you for my little 2-bedroom, 1 bath. And baby, as bad as the economy is now in this mortgage meltdown, you better thank God for whatever you have. I don't know who you are in this place, but I want to pray for you. You're stuck between your place of departure and your place of destiny. You know that God has more for your life. Got a grander future for your life, but it just seems as if I'm not there yet. Been discouraged, depressed, bothering you. Would you meet me at this altar? I want to pray for you. I didn't come for recreational religion. I didn't come just to preach. I came because my friend invited me. And second of all, I'm here because I believe I'm on assignment. You don't have to stay in that wilderness. You were not created to dwell in that wilderness. Child of God, man of God, woman of God, he has a fabulous future for your life. And you can't give up. No, you can't give up right now. No. You've come too far. From when you've shed too many tears, you've sacrificed. No, you can't give up now. The devil is a lie. You got to go all the way. You got to persevere. Pull yourself together. Plant your feet, square your shoulders, lift up your head. God has a future for your life, and I want to pray for you. Would you bow your heads with me? Oh God, our God, I thank you and I praise you even now for your word.
Hallelujah.
For the power of your word.
Yes, God,
I pray now for these men and women that stand before your presence. God, I pray for them now that you would give them the courage, give them the faith to trust you.
Oh God, I pray even now for that person who's at a crossroad in life, having to make a decision to go in a new direction. Guide them even now in this decision-making moment. Let them not lean into their own understanding, but let them acknowledge you. God, I pray right now for that person who feels like throwing in the towel. Touch their hearts. Heal their spirits. Give them a fresh view of their vision, of their future. I pray now for fresh vision. God, I pray not for a picture that's in black and white. Give it in high definition color. Give them a fresh, clear picture of where you're seeking to take them, their marriage, their business, their lives. But let them see it even now. I thank you, God, that even in the midst of the wilderness, we've had turbulence, we've had trouble, we've had tragedies, but you've kept us through it all. And we have not lacked at all. We bless your name. Now be with these, your people, I pray. In Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, would you encourage someone else? Come on, encourage someone else. 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 Come on, encourage someone else.
Subscribe to Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube. We post brand new content every week with powerful preaching for ministers and pastors all across the nation that seek to encourage people all over the world through the word of Jesus Christ. You will also find gospel songs and old-time hymns that have inspired generations of Christians. Subscribe today and hit the bell so you never miss new content. YouTube.com/Brother Rollins. Spell it. B-R-O-T-H-A Rollins. Brother Rollins Videos for Christ on YouTube.